I wanted my baby for an illustration. Who here knows that? How does that song go again? Whatever will be the future, blah, blah. You know that one? How does it start? Sarah. Yeah. Baloney. Who knows that that's a lie? Yes. That you actually get to control a lot of your future. There's some things that are outside of your control, but you get choices. We talked last week about the power of choice, which is actually the essence of faith. Faith isn't blind. People are like, you gotta just have faith, blind faith. There's nothing about faith that's blind.
Yeah.
The essence of faith is mine and your response to Jesus and to what he's saying. So, I know how my baby came to be. Through a deliberate process, and then the baby grows, which is the miraculous part, right? But somebody's like, oh, I don't know how she got pregnant. Who's ever heard that before? I got my girlfriend pregnant. How did she get pregnant? I don't know. Really? I do. And guess what? It's on you, buddy. You made that happen. Now, the miraculous part of it is God's thing. And that's why a life of faith is 100% God and 100% you. A walk with God is 100% God, his faithfulness, his love, his beauty, his glory, his breakthrough, but it's 100% you. Your response, your choice, your dedication, your faithfulness, your perseverance. So it's God and you. And I loved that meeting with Daryl because Daryl said something key that I shared at our core group meeting. He said, fatalism is a demonic theology. And I was like, what is... And I know that. Fatalism basically is that song. Sarah, Sarah, whatever will be, will be. You know? And fatalism is what that woman was bound by. She wasn't expecting God to do a miracle. That young woman actually died last night. She was on drugs and she walked away. She grew up in church, grew up in a youth group. Drugs and alcohol and whatever, just went off the deep end. Tried to commit suicide. She's in the hospital and she died. Now, that is partly, she tried to commit suicide. So it is on her. But could we have prayed harder and saw a breakthrough? I don't know. But what I do know is that prayer is powerful. What I do know is that me standing in front of you is a result of prayer. What I do know is that when I was 16, God got some kid named Josh Pitka who was dealing drugs and dropped out of high school, didn't care about himself, I was a filthy person. You don't know me before I got, you don't know me minus Jesus equals sinner. How about you? Me minus Jesus, selfish, lustful, pervert, didn't care about anyone, beat kids up for no reason. I don't even want to say the things that I did. Because they were just evil. It was sinful, evil. That's who I was. Enter Jesus, life change. Yeah. But my grandma, who's a woman of God, told me the Holy Spirit would wake her up in the wee hours of the morning, 2-3 o'clock. She would fall on her knees and begin to weep and cry out to God for my soul. How many kids go down that road and never return? How many kids have brain grandmas?
Don't underestimate the power of your prayers.
Yeah.
Don't underestimate the power of your faith, your response to God. Your life before Him can transform multitudes. I thank God for my praying grandma. A prophet came up to me and said, "You don't know, actually, there were thousands of people praying, maybe thousands of people praying for you. They had whole prayer circles that they were God, just praying for me." And I didn't even have someone come up and preach to me. I had kids at school preaching to me. I just shook it off. God coupled in my life. It's the power of prayer. It's the power of light. It's the power of His Word. But He's chosen not to control you. He's given you a spirit. It's who you are. You are a spirit, and you have a body temporarily, and He's going to give you a new one in heaven. But you are a spirit, and you have control over your words and over your actions.
Yeah.
Powerful, powerful stuff. I want to encourage you, before we get into the Word, to become a person of prayer. You pray enough, you get close enough to God, and it will automatically lead to people getting saved, preaching, evangelism, all that stuff. But the problem with prayer is it's not necessarily entertaining. And we live in an entertainment-driven generation right now. Everything is about entertainment. Everything is about make me happy. Everything is about satisfy that itch. And you come to God and you say, "Entertain me!" And He says, "What do I look like? An actor?" And He speaks a word to you. I don't want that. We may not even consciously do it, but He speaks truth to us. The only way that you're going to live for Jesus is if you give Him your life and you say, "I will die to myself." Which is actually the foundation and the key to true happiness.
Yep.
We're created for love. But love isn't a feeling, people. It's not primarily a feeling. You can feel love. Love is a choice. It's a choice. Obedience to God is a choice. The grace of God is in you to help you, but He's never going to control you. We're not in a cult. Cult will try to control you. This pastor will tell you, give your life to Jesus. Lay down your life. Stop trying to get Him to entertain you. He's not an entertainer. He's God. He'll satisfy you, but He'll also be Lord of your life. He'll change you, but He'll also give you the option to change. Amen. We're going to go to one verse today. 2 Corinthians 11, 13. 2 Corinthians 11, 3. You guys all right? Let's pray. Holy Spirit, we love You. We thank You. Speak to our hearts this morning a word that will change us. It's my prayer. I don't want to do normal church. Lord, You know me. You see everything. You see every motivation of my heart. You see my mind. You see my heart. You see it right through me. You know every thought that I think. And You know that I'm sincere when I pray. Lord, I don't want to do church. I'm not here to perform. I'm not here because I need a microphone. I just need You, Jesus. But I pray that every person under the sound of my voice would come to a new level because of Your Word and because of Your Spirit. Let Your Word and Your Spirit prevail in this house this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, one verse. You ready? Mm-hmm. Paul says, "But I am afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. I'm going to read that in the New International Version.
Take that off the screen for a minute, James.
Just listen with your heart. New International Version. People ask me sometimes, well, what version is the best? I'm like, I tell them I read ESV because that's what the Lord has me in. And I like it. And it's one of the best versions, I think. But people are like,
well, the King James Version only is the version you can use. It's the holy version.
You hear this all the time. Baloney. The King James Version was written in 1600s. So if you want to talk like thee and thou and, you know, follow the Lord whithersoever he may goest, then that's for you. But if you don't understand something, if you're like me and you're like, I don't understand that, then you probably want like a New Living Translation or even the Message or something like this. Because words communicate truth. Or lies. But God is truth. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. So it doesn't matter necessarily what version you use. It matters the Holy Spirit is imparting truth into your hearts. Does that make sense? The Word of God is not words. It's truth communicated by words that you read. So the impact comes when truth is revealed by the Holy Spirit. Amen? So I'm going to read out a bunch of versions because I want you to get this. New International Version says, I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds may somehow be led astray from your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. New Living Translation says it this way, but I fear that somehow your pure and undivided devotion to Christ will be corrupted, just as Eve was deceived by the cunning ways of the serpent. New American Standard says, but I am afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, your minds will be led astray from the simplicity. Who here likes simple things? Me too. Every man's hand should go right up.
Oh, yeah.
Here, trust me. You didn't marry your wife because she was simple. Oh my God. You married her because you loved her. Because you wanted to be devoted to her. Right? Amen? You fall in love with someone because well, you love them and you're deciding, I'm going to be devoted to you, I'm going to love you, and you only. But you're never going to think, wow, my relationship will just be simple. Who knows? God is even more complex than a woman. I remember a man of God said to God one time, he said, I served you for 40 years and I still don't understand you. And the man said, dude, you've been married 40 years, you don't even understand your wife yet. How do you think you're going to understand me? God is even more complex than a woman. It's an amazing thought, I know. But he calls us to simplicity. Even though you'll never understand all of his ways, even though his ways are higher than your ways, he wants to bring you up to a life in him, but it's very simple and it's very pure. Now, you know that simple doesn't necessarily mean easy. Simple and easy are not the same word. Simple just means it's right in front of you. It's not hard to grasp. It's simple, pure. King James Version. But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve by his craftiness, your minds will be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ.
That's not the King James Version, that was the New American Standard again. King James. But I fear lest by any means, as a serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. The Jubilee Bible says it this way. I fear that as the serpent deceived Eve through his craftiness, so your senses should be corrupted in the same way, that ye should fall from the simplicity that is in the Christ. I have like 20 versions here. Mm-hmm. I'm going to read one more. But the U.A. Rheims Bible. But I fear lest as the serpent seduced Eve by his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted and fall from the simplicity that is in Christ. Let me ask you this. How did the serpent deceive Eve?
He lied.
He lied. How? What did he tell her? Does anybody know?
Did God really say?
See, in Christ, you have everything that you need. The Bible says in Christ, in his glory, is everything that you need that pertains to life and godliness. Everything you need is found in following Jesus. Did you hear me? Everything you need is found by following Jesus. Everything. Well, I need a husband. Well, follow Jesus. I need money. Okay, follow Jesus. Because he said, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all the things you need will be added to you. Well, I sure would like to have some fun too. Follow Jesus. There is no one who is more fun than Jesus. I kid you not. You looking for some excitement? Get a hold of the Christ. He's crazy. Well, I sure would like to have an adventure in my life. I don't just want to live like just a boring Christian life. Well, get a hold of this Jesus. Get a hold of the cross and begin to follow him. I promise you, you are in for the greatest adventure of your life. Especially for men. I just have this aggression. I just don't want to be like a pious church boy. I want to be a warrior. You want to be a warrior? Follow Jesus. He will give you the battle of your lifetime. Now, I read the Bible sometimes and I'm like, especially the Old Testament, and I feel like, why wasn't I born in these days? I'm serious. Just like, give me a sword. I tell you, I would have been a warrior. I am a warrior, but because I have a fight in me, I have an aggression in me, but I channel it into following Jesus. I don't know how many heads of the devil I've ripped off in my lifetime. Many, many. David said in Psalm 18, I said, I hate my enemy with a perfect hatred. Trust me, I love God, but I hate the works of darkness. I hate what they do to people. I hate when believers are deceived by the same trick that the enemy used on Eve and that he's been using through the generations. God says to you, everything you need is in me. And he comes and says, did God really say, the nerve of him to say, wait to get married. Wait to have sex until you get married. Did God mean that, really? Did God say that? When you hear that voice, did God say, wait? Yes, he did say wait. Why? Because he wants you to be blessed and have a pure marriage bed. He wants you to trust each other. He wants you to have a life together that will be unhindered by compromise. You start getting on fire for God, make a little money, and you feel,
I sure would like to tithe. And then you write out that check, and the enemy comes and says, did God say that? And you look up on the internet, and all these people think, you know, there's opinions about everything.
Well, tithing really isn't New Testament. No, New Testament is to give everything to God. I believe tithing, which means giving 10% of your income back to the storehouse of your local church, is the training wheels of giving. I don't even want to tell you how much I give and how much I've given, because it would, you'd feel bad. Because I live for heaven. And I pray that you would live for heaven too. That's why we're in church this morning. Running my business, which I'm starting to make some money now, which is cool. And I felt, you know, last week I felt God say, wire Derek or send Derek Schneider $200. I'm like, And I told my wife, and she just laughed at me and said, oh, man. Because I always said, Carly, I feel like we're supposed to give so-and-so a gift. And she goes, oh, no. Because usually it's 500 or 1,000, which is a lot. She's like, how much? And I said, 200. She goes, whew. She said, can we make it 100? I said, no. But every word, you have to understand this as a believer. Every word or promise that God gives you,
come on,
the enemy will be right there saying, did God say? Did God really say? Come on. How could that be God? I told the church a month or two ago, the Lord spoke to my heart and said, son, your ministry is beginning today. And it was like the beginning of July or June. I can't remember. No, the beginning of July, he said, your ministry is just beginning. I said, what have we been doing for the last 10 years? Because we were doing Friday nights, we were a youth ministry, we were up to 100 people, and then and I burnt out, and then I didn't want to even be a pastor anymore, and God wouldn't let me go and said, you need to start another church on Sunday. And so, and Mark Fossey just carried the load and preached for 3 months, and we were this little 10 people now, and I'm like, I'm done. God said, God spoke to my heart and said, you're going to be a church of thousands of people in 40 years, over 100,000 people, and like campuses all over Canada. I'm like, what? God, how is that going to happen? He laid out a strategy for me and said, if the 50, 60 people in this room, if this year you won one person to Christ, the church, and in 12 years doing that, we'd be millions. Do you know there's 2 billion believers in the world today? If every believer won one this year, that's 4 billion. If we did it again, the earth is covered with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord.
Amen.
The problem is, too many believers backslide and then don't do anything. Why do they backslide? Because they listen to the voice, the same voice that beguiled Eve.
Yeah.
You know that. I'm going to get rid of this thing because it keeps me squeaky. You start to get on fire for God. This happened to me. I started to get on fire for God at age 16, 17, 18. I loved him. I spent time with him. But guess what? I still had the fear of man inside of me. And I started feeling like, this is what will happen. You get on fire for God, and he'll tell you. He fills you up with his precious Holy Spirit. He'll start to tell you to give him away to people. And now you really have to die to yourself. Because it's one thing to receive a gift, it's another thing to give. Jesus said, more blessed are those who give than even those who receive. Jesus says, you like getting gifts? You want to be happier? So to become a giver. And I tell you the truth, there is a higher level of anointing and power and substance of the Holy Spirit in giving him away than even receiving him. The most glorious, some of the most glorious times I've had is sitting with homeless people or evangelizing on the streets or preaching in different places. The power of the Holy Ghost. It's one thing to receive the Holy Spirit. It's another thing to give Him away. So when the Lord started telling me, I'd be walking down the street and I'd see three young people and I'd just hear that voice, go talk to them. Right away. There's no God. Did God really say? And I had to wrestle this thing down to the ground and realize God was not a respecter of my fear. He's not a respecter of my ego. God isn't a respecter of my image before man. He doesn't respect my sin. He doesn't respect my feelings. He's God, and He says, you want to follow me? Up to you, but it's going to cost you your life. And this is the gospel. We get to live and follow Jesus, but it costs us our life. Throw up that verse again, James. I'm afraid, Paul says. So am I. I look at all you guys, and I feel afraid sometimes. No, I don't have fear in my heart of the enemy, but I fear for you. That somehow the enemy would convince you. You know what? Serve God when you're older. Live a little. Live a little. What does that even mean? You mean sin and then die a little? Live a little. Just live your life and then when you're older, then serve God. You don't know how many people I've heard say that. Some of you, the enemy got you when you were a young person. And you just wasted your years. Thank God He can restore everything that was taken. But we live in it. We are in the time right now where you can actually waste. You can waste years, decades of your life even, simply by the enemy saying, God didn't mean that. He didn't mean give your whole life. He just wants you to go to church once in a while. So the church is irrelevant to most of the world because most believers' lives are caught in this balance. They're not really following Jesus. They're yielding their minds and their hearts and their bodies and their time and their emotions to the enemy. They're still Christians. They still love Jesus. But they yield themselves to that voice. Did God come? Did He really mean that? I remember one time, I told this story before, but most of you haven't heard it. It was my 17th birthday. I was just saved. My parents were thrilled, of course. I was serving Jesus. And they said, what do you want for your birthday? I said, I don't know, gold necklace maybe. Looking at Louisa's gold necklace there. My parents bought me like a $150 box chain gold necklace. And I had a guy who came and I just read, I told you I was going to go to one scripture. Let's go to one more. This is just so good. Luke chapter 6. Verse 27. Jesus says, but I say to you who hear, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. Who here lives this out? These are tough words. Jesus said, I say to you here, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. To one who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. From one who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who begs from you. And from the one who takes away your goods, And as you wish others, take away your goods, do not demand them back. As you wish others to do to you, do also to them. Wow. If you love those who love you, what benefit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what benefit is that? Even sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to get back the same amount. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return. It's one thing to read it. It's another thing when a Christian guy who you've been hanging out with who's a little wonky when you're 17, you just get this gold box and then you just necklace and then you read this, give to everyone who asks from you and don't even ask it back. And he said to me, he had the audacity to say, it was so funny. It was like God was testing me. He pointed out the scripture. He said, you know that scripture, Josh, that God says, give everyone to who asks and da-da-da. I said, yeah. He said, can I have your necklace? And I said, with joy in my heart, I kid you not. I said, sure you can. And I took it off, and I gave it to him, and I said, I have a reward in heaven now. I was such a new Christian, but the reality of Jesus Christ was so real to me. I said, now I get to bless him, and I have a reward in heaven. This is awesome. My parents were furious. But it was the joy of my heart to give. It's the joy of my heart later on this afternoon when I click the button and send Derek Schneider $200. Why? Because I get to bless a man of God. And I have reward in heaven. And I live for heaven. I don't live for this, Your life on earth is 70, 80 years, the Bible says. Compared to eternity, mathematically, that 70, 80 years is zero time. It's nothing. Nothing. And what you do on earth directly affects your eternity. So when you grasp living your life in the light of eternity, you start to reject that voice. Did God say? Yes, he did. When you get to know this word and you meditate in it day and night, and you're writing out your tithe check, or whatever the Lord's told you to give, or if he told you to bless someone, or if he told you to do something, you're going to go do it. And the enemy might come and say, see, I tell you the truth. I actually don't really. You can actually come to a place where you don't struggle with the enemy anymore. Because you just know God too well. I tell you the truth. And then in the areas that you may be weak, you have leadership that can speak truth into your life. You have godly friendships and accountability that can help you. That's why we do church together. But you can actually come to a place where, God say, shut up. I saw a Baptist pastor one time, his little girl was like three or four years old. He would pretend he was the voice of the enemy. He would go,
you're ugly.
And she would grab his hand and say, no, I'm not. I am beautiful in Christ Jesus. And I just felt just the Holy Ghost all over that. I said, what is he doing? He's teaching his young daughter to recognize the voice of the enemy.
That's awesome.
And proclaim the truth.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Very powerful.
Yeah.
Some of us still, someone was telling me earlier on today, I feel condemned. I said, well, that's a lie. They said, I know, but. Well, it's a lie.
Yeah.
Reject it and declare there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But maybe I made a mistake. Maybe you did.
Mm-hmm.
Thank God you recognize it.
Yeah.
because most people don't. You know who the greatest people in the world are, don't you? Not those who never make mistakes. It's those who make the most. Why? Because they repent the most. What does repentance do? It exalts you. Repentance makes you stronger. And the more you follow Jesus, the more mistakes you're going to make, and the more you're going to repent, and the higher you're going to go. You think you can follow Jesus and not make mistakes, and not fall down, and not sin once in a while? You got another thing coming to you. The more hardcore you are, the more you're going to recognize the flaws inside of you, and the more you're going to come to Jesus, and the more he's going to teach you, and the higher you're going to go. That's a good word for somebody in here. You're looking at a guy who's made a couple sins. My wife can attest, even in the time we've been married, I've made at least a dozen mistakes.
This morning. Sorry, me too.
Okay, we're gonna finish with I'm actually gonna read a few more scriptures. I'm sorry. Please forgive me for reading the Bible when we're in church. Let's go to Matthew 22. We're gonna Matthew 22, 37. Let's just read this. We're gonna close with this. It said this, I wrote this down. It's all about Jesus. We are made from him. Did you guys know that? The Word of God is what breathed life into us. The substance of your spirit is made from the substance of God. That's what gives you life. You're not just anatomical, whatever. You're not just living. You're not just a mechanism. You're actually living. You're not just a machine. You actually have the spirit of life inside of you. And God has given you a spirit. It's awesome. We're made from him. We are made for him. We find our fulfillment in him. He is our salvation. He is our God. He is our friend. He is our love. Through him, we come into the Father's embrace, a Father who will never leave you or forsake you, a God who is love. So this is my message this morning. Keep it simple. Keep it focused on Jesus. Keep your nose in the Bible. Be a person of truth. Just like that old Martin Smith Delirious song, he said, if there's a preacher here, come on, won't you preach the truth? I want to know more about Jesus. Yeah, that's what this church is about. We're about Jesus. What do you do on Sunday mornings? We worship Jesus. What does the preacher talk about? Jesus. Who do you love? Jesus. Who do you obey? Jesus. Where's your faith? It's in Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. It's all about Jesus. I tell you, as you keep it focused on Jesus, it's going to be very difficult for you to be deceived. Because you'll hear, and immediately you'll go, Jesus, what do you think about that? You'll hear someone say something to you, and you'll measure it by the life and teaching of Jesus. Plus, to boot, you got the Holy Spirit inside of you, leading you and convicting you and filling you and prodding you. Amen? Okay, we're going to close with a few scriptures here. Matthew 22, 37. Matthew 34 says, but when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. One of them, a lawyer, asked him the question to test him. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. The great and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. So what does God tell us to do? Love him. What does God tell us to do? Love him. People ask me, what is, I don't know my purpose. I do. Is to love God. Well, what about what? Love Him. Pour your life out to Him. Love Him more. This is what you're created to do. I don't know, I can't find joy in my life. Love God. You'll find joy. I don't know if I can't find peace in my life. You know where peace is? In the love of God. Trust me, when you know whose you are, you'll know who you are, and you'll have peace. But if you don't know even why you're breathing oxygen, how can you have peace? All you can do is try to have fun, more fun, and it just leads to death anyway, which I'm talking about fun as in the form of the city. Love Him. Mark, that was Matthew, let's go to Mark 12. Mark 12, verse 30. Verse 28, actually. And one of the scribes came and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that he answered them all well, saying, asked him, which commandment is the most important of all? Jesus answered, the most important is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. You start to love Him with all your heart, with all your soul. What is your soul? Your mind, your intellect, your will, your emotions. You start to love Him with all your strength. I tell you, I'm up there worshiping, and I just, the presence of the Lord is so good, I can't help weeping. Because I'm overwhelmed by His goodness. And I'm sweating and coming out my back and I'm all sticky. What is that? Strength. Alarm goes off in the morning, I sit in bed, the devil goes, did God say 5 a.m. really? Oh no, I think he's probably meant 7. But you stand up, wobble down, put the coffee on. What is that? It's loving the Lord with your strength. The will, the strength, the stuff inside of you that He's given you to love Him with. It's not just your heart. People say, well, I know I'm in sin, but I love God with my heart. Yeah, but you're not loving Him with your soul or your mind or your strength.
Yeah.
So you're not fulfilling the great commandment. Because you're not loving God with all of you. He wants all of you. He wants all of you. He wants all of you, not just your heart. You'll hear that a lot. Come on to church. God, no, I don't need to go to church. I just love God with my heart. I believe you. But what about loving Him with your soul? What about loving people as you love yourself? Who knows it's okay to love themselves? Yeah. Yes. Oh, did she say this or yes? Yes! So I'm doing church a little bit differently than I did before because I put myself before you. If I'm feeling too tired and I see a phone call, I just start to call them back. Sometimes I don't respond to texts for days. Because I know if I'm going to be effective as a person, I need to put myself first. The biggest downfall of pastors and passionate people, Christians, is that they put everybody else first and then they burn out. Love the Lord. There's last scripture. We're going to close here. Luke 10. Luke 10, 27. Behold, 25, a lawyer stood up to him, put him to the test, saying, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. As your neighbor has said, he said to him, you've answered correctly, do this, and you
will live. It's so simple. My prayer for you this morning is that even the rest of this summer, you would not be dragged to and fro by anything else, any other voice, but that you, your heart would be guided by the simplicity and pure devotion that God calls you to. He doesn't call you to know everything. He calls you to love him. He calls you to seek him. He calls you to obey him. You do that, you will be blessed. You will have life. You will be happy. And this is the key for the nations of the world to love God. Father, I just thank you, in Jesus' name, for your word. It's simple, but it's your word this morning. Lord, I just pray that every person under the sound of my voice just quiet your spirit right now. Quiet your mind. Just close your eyes. I need to be obedient to God right now. Just close your eyes. Searched you, and I know you. I know when you sit down and when you rise up, I discern your thoughts from afar. I search out your path and you're lying down. I am acquainted with all of your ways. Even before a word is on your tongue, I, the Lord, know it altogether. I have hemmed you in behind and before, and I have laid my hand upon you. Such knowledge is too wonderful. It is so high, you can never understand it. So where shall you go from my spirit? Or where could you flee from my presence? If you ascend to heaven, I'm there. If you make your bed in Sheol, I'm there. If you take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there my hand shall lead you, and my right hand shall hold you. If you say, surely the darkness covers me, and the light is far from me, even the darkness is not dark to me. The night is bright as the day. The darkness is as light to me. For I formed your inward parts. I knitted you together in your mother's womb. Praise me, for you are fearfully and wonderfully made. My works are wonderful, and I want your soul to know it. Your frame was not hidden from me. When I made you in secret, I intricately wove you together. My eyes saw your unformed substance. In my book, they were written, every one of them. Your days were formed by me, when as yet there were none of them. How precious are my thoughts toward you. How vast are the sum of them. If you would count them, they are more numerous than the sand of the seashore. When you awake, I am still. The Lord wants you to know this morning that he loves you. Oh, I feel it so strong. He loves you. And all he has is goodness for you. His heart is full of plans for your life. And if you will yield your life to him, he will bless you beyond your wildest dreams. Hello. Amen. Whew. Have a wonderful day. Be filled with